we've got some in the offices, no. I don't know if that's just, if you like, in the, just when things are put together, it's not remembered.
Well, of course, it's council, I think that's a typo, in online part, and the all proofreading, so, apologies.
Okay.
And what proofreading, I mean.
Is the idea.
There's only one paper which I can't afford, and I think I know what you are, so on page 61.
A61.
Yes. Have I got this right? The North London West Plan, the preparation of a local plan in winter 2014, and application was winter 2019. Is there any explanation of that?
Since we have two members of the North London West Authority, rather than their answer, I will problem. I think I share your view of that authority. Is that a satisfactory answer?
Well, what concerns me is I believe the prepared plan is going to be 2014 to 2025, will be a plan timetable. So it's due to be adopted in the winter 2020 for the last 3 months. We'll never start on a new plan.
That's a good observation, but I stand by my commitment that after last time, we will be the last council to confirm our agreement to it. Okay. Any other observations?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, Councillor
McGurk,
sorry.
Yeah. In the report, you've got in there the Collindale SPV and the Middlesex University Hendon Campus SPD. Obviously, this is my first time at B&R, but I remember the North Finchley SPD going through and having done a lot of work with it. I don't see what actually use are the SPDs, because things are happening in North Finchley that absolutely have no links to the SPD that was approved by B&R. I just think, what is the point of them? Yeah, there's applications, planning applications coming in, work going on in North Finchley, that have no relation to the SPD that was approved by the PNR. I understand, I think they're a very, very good idea, and I think we should have more of them. I have to be with Whetstone, who is a really good area to have them on, because the amount of building would go there. But I'm just thinking, what ownership, you've proven the PNR, how do we have officers and councillors to have the same when somebody comes in and wants to do some building work, the post office being major possible development site in North Finchley, how can we say, well, if anyone comes in wants to do something there, so this is the SPD, how do we hold any developers to account for what we as a council approve?
The SPD forms a part of the planning application in that area.
But it doesn't.
It's not, well, it does.
It doesn't seem to.
It doesn't.
It certainly offers some requirements to consider the SPD along with
some of the other factors. But our office is going to do that without a so many things, it's just we have got concerns. I've been around to assess the meeting with the six councillors in North Finchley.
Certainly the officers are considering any application that we've got a threshold of competency level. Absolutely, we have regard to the SPD in taking that decision. Obviously, it's discussed a specific case outside of that people.
Thank you, Chair. It's page 62, the New Southgate Opportunity Area. I'm assuming this is in very early days thus far. Have you had meetings yet with the leaders of Enfield and Haringey councils about setting up a joint partnership board or something like that?
Not currently, because I think that would be a very bad idea.
Yes, they are quite new.
Yes, I look forward to that.
On page 55 talks about the seal, but that is within the local development plan and so on. Therefore, although it was introduced in May 2013, it cannot be revised until it's adopted in the winter 2020. Is there any way that we're looking at the seal, and maybe given the financial situation, can be done earlier outside this process? Because it seems like that might be an opportunity to bring in more money rather than wait until 2020. I don't know if it's 3 months.
I don't think it is. I'm just
obviously from my colleagues in the audience that can nod or shake their head from afar. They can start the process of
shake.
There was, and
you
see,
it's
really
bad. The statutory process for reviewing so which are at one stage or which we have to go through, and that we started it now, we'll be just finishing it when we have to restart it for the new plan. So it's just more about the logistics. We have to do it for the new plan, and we're looking at publishing a draft document early next year for public consultation. And we're going to be doing the civil charge schedule review in tandem with that process. So we have, if we started it now, we'd be doing the case area for a year down the line. And it's really just about not over consulting and making it as simple as possible in the process.
Well, I think so, except that Shafted Mary could bring an initiative to decide on an increase in civil drinking a year earlier, and then the Ecker local town just be confirming that that's a new service, which you have to do. I'm just, to be honest, is this a way of bringing in money a year earlier? If it's not, it's not. But
I think if we had a slightly delayed local plan, it would be, I think we would just duplicating the cost process of doing it twice, and it's not ideal because we would be going out to consult with people next year on a civil charge schedule review and then again in the following year. So it's really just about keeping stakeholders not over consulting and using the process as simply as possible.
Welcome your comments on the government's new methodology for population we want plan, because given the vehemence with which you criticise the mayor for setting challenging targets for Barnet, this figure is considerably higher than the mayor. So perhaps the government are an enemy of the people of Barnet in your language. I think challenging targets should be set, but I welcome your comment on that.
Impossible targets. We mentioned about the consultation with our neighbouring boroughs and Enfield Heritage I think those are very far advanced and irregular, and that's very much part of our planning process. I'm interested in whether our consultation with Hertfordshire and Hertfordshire County Council when it comes to the development of our local plan is similarly integrated, and whether there is need for evidence gathering at this stage as to what the plans they are going forward, particularly obviously in the areas that are close to or even connected with our borough.
So preparing a local plan, you have to agree a statement of common ground with all adjoining authorities. We work very closely with obviously the London boroughs, but also the boroughs outside of London to the north. And we will agree with them a statement of common ground where we agree what we're going to do with that land which we share in terms of the boundary. And that's something which officers do on a regular basis. We meet with the colleagues and the spurs and work with them on their plans as well.
I mean, do you think that our connection with what's going on in Hertfordshire is as close as it is with the surrounding London boroughs? Because again and again we hear about the connection to the London boroughs, and rightly so. And but nonetheless, I don't think I've ever really heard about the connections that we have with what's going on to the north, and I don't quite know what their development time, their development pipeline is going to look like and how that might impact on Barnet.
It's true to say that the majority of our work is with the London boroughs, where the development pressure is. We find that the authorities to the north are managing to contain their development and grow within their built-up areas, and so the impact of what's going on in Hertfordshire and others has less effect on Barnet. But we do communicate with them, but yes, the balance of our work is more just the London boroughs at the moment.
Thank you very much. And a statement of
Okay, just one question. I don't know if it's a new thing, but some explanation of permission in principle. Is this something else the government brought in that developers can be assumed to have planning permission unless there's a specific way from the government rather than that? In other words, if there's planning on a brownfield solar power or solar, is this the new government rule that you have to assume it's okay unless there's a specific reason why not?
The permission in principle is a fairly new statutory process. It came in about 18 months ago as part of the Brownfield Land Register scheme. Barnet has a Brownfield Land Register which identifies sites which are capable of development on brownfields, but we've only included sites to date which have either been previously allocated in the development plan or have had planning permission in the past. Once the site gets onto part one of the register, the owner can then apply for permission in principle. We've resisted putting sites on as part one to mitigate against developers coming forward for permission in principle. So it does make the process much easier and gives the council less control in terms of what can go on a site. So we've had a very cautious approach to date on what goes on as part one, but inevitably as we go forward, probably will start to receive applications for permission in principle. And there is a process, it's not just straight whereby a developer will get a permission, there will still be an application process, but it will be simpler than the current process that we see planning
applications. Presumably any objection to it has to be on detailed plan grant like traffic or the look of it, not on the fact that it exists, if you see what I mean. Which probably when you said that it was previously a planning permission, because there might be, not greenfield sites, look like surfaces that had planning permission before, which may be for a lot smaller development. To put it through the data, somebody that got planning permission to build a couple of houses, for whatever reason hasn't, somebody comes and says, well, 13 flats on there, and I'll claim permission. Permission in principle, is that possible?
The process does have limits on it, so it's not a free for all, but there will be an effect. Very few authorities have a process for permission in principle. Everybody's been very cautious, and we haven't really got any evidence to show from other authorities how it's working in practice. I think we'll continue to take a cautious approach in Barnet until we become. So we understand what the implications are.
Just a technical question. In terms of permission in principle, does it cover all potential use classes in terms of source of development, or is it restricted?
It's restricted to extension to
the existing.
Just following on from some previous comments with regard to planning applications, just to be very clear about this, do we have legal guidance that says we are entitled to remove slash not consider any planning representations that contain prejudiced, i.e. racist, homophobic, etc. comments as part of it's obviously part one of the application that we've had in the borough.
If we were to receive an objection to a planning application that contains, say, a racist or a homophobic comment, could we disregard that objection?
I think you could disregard it yourself.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much. So, going back to the recommendations on page 63, a note of approval and a delegation of authority. Are we happy with that? Thank you very much. The next item is deferred. Then we come on to the CBAT tool, licensing it to external parties. Seems a very sensible measure. Seems like anything to say. Seems to be a win-win thing. Okay, take that as read. Thank you very much. The IT key strategy in this case for the... I thought so. Did everyone bring on the seat back to? Yeah. Implementation of the IT strategy. Does anyone have any comments to make on that page? We're not really finding any implementation.
Sent to the